Here is the great John McEnroe.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you so much for being here. Oh, you know all these clips with you here that we saw. They make a lot of people nostalgic.
That's a nice way of putting it. Yeah.
What about yourself? What do you feel when you look at yourself many years ago?
Which part? The part where I'm hitting the cup?
All of it.
I see that on YouTube. My kids show me on YouTube the part where I get mad, and they've made clips and, you know, cut all my greatest moments to about 5 or 10 minutes. So I guess that's good in a way, because otherwise no one would know who the hell I am, I guess. And obviously for me, Sweden's, especially Stockholm, is very important or historic for me, because my best rival, my great friend Bjorn Borg, we first played here in Stockholm in 1978, so I've been coming here for 38 years now. So I can't believe I'm still playing tennis.
Have you met Bjorn now when you're here? Have you talked to him?
Well, he's very nice. He always gives me some free underwear when I come to Stockholm. So I just saw him, and I play another good friend of mine later, Mats Wilander, who came along because of Bjorn. I think he started a revolution in tennis, maybe the way this gentleman started a revolution in electronic music. And so now there's a problem in Sweden and the U.S. We don't have many players. Yeah. So maybe that's why there's still a void for the seniors, the old guys. We get to play. But Bjorn and I are going to have some dinner later. Maybe have a beer or two or something.
But what are you talking? Do you talk about the old days or do you talk about now?
We prefer to talk about politics and things moving forward instead of what happened on Match Point in Wimbledon in 1980. Because honestly, we don't remember. They always show these clips, and it's sort of the same couple matches, because my most famous match was obviously the match with Bjorn, and the one that I lost in 1980. I actually beat him the next year, but no one remembers that part. But a lot of people don't realize that when I won the tiebreaker, this long tiebreaker, 18-16 in the fourth set, they thought that I won the match. So I don't tell people that I lost. It's nice to be part of history. Yeah. Obviously, if you do something for a living and then people remember you for a particular rivalry or a match like the one at Wimbledon. And I think the best part for me personally is that Bjorn and I are still, we still get along. I think he was the only one of my rivals that I actually got along with. Everyone else I was fighting all the time.
He's kind of a mystery to even to Swedes as a person. Is he a mystery for you as well?
Not really, no. I think he's believe it or not, our personalities are pretty similar. We have the same sense of humor. I think we think about things in a similar way, whether it's something serious or something that's not so serious. And I think maybe people think when he was 10 or 12 years old that his father supposedly, when he misbehaved, believe it or not, at one stage, Bjorn Borg misbehaved. So in the 12 and unders, he behaved worse than I did. But I guess...
We didn't know that.
Well, I don't think very many people would believe that. But apparently his father suspended him or wouldn't let him play tennis for 6 months and put away the rackets. So I think a lot of people that watch tennis or cover wish that my father had done the same thing when I was 12 years old. But the truth is I wasn't that bad when I was 12. It was only when I got older that I realized how bad the umpires really were. And that we needed to change the sport, and we needed to maybe, like, I can't speak too much for skiing, but I know that tennis, and I think skiing is the same, it's too expensive, and it's not accessible for a lot of people. And one of the things that maybe my biggest disappointment as a tennis player is that hasn't changed. You know, it's still too expensive to participate, and it's not enough opportunity. So hopefully in the next, I don't know, 10, 50 years, we'll have more people playing.
Back in the days when you played and you and Björn were the top rivals, you were also like, as you said, friends, and you could enjoy New York nightlife together, like in.
Well, they could do that now if they wanted. They just, I don't know. I don't
just
think
boring they, people probably.
Well, I'll let you say that. We had a mutual friend. His name was Vitas Gerulaitis, and he was very popular at Studio 54, which was like at the time it was like the place that you would hope that you could get into, and if you were ranked like five in the world, like I was, they say that didn't matter. You had to have something special. So I always tried to get into Studio 54 when Vitas went. So it's true that at that time, maybe when less was at stake, it was easier to have a little bit more fun.
Who could be there?
It could be Mick Jagger and, you know, anyone from the Rolling Stones, although it seemed only at that time that he wanted to go there. There could be, like, the royalty from, like, Monaco, Princess Caroline.
David Bowie?
David Bowie, God rest his soul, was fantastic. And yeah, he could have been there. It was like a dream. Andy Warhol was there every night. You know, every party I ever went to in New York, Andy Warhol was there. David Bowie, one time, very quick, 30 seconds. I was staying in the same hotel as David Bowie, and maybe around 1980, 81, I started to play the guitar, try to learn the guitar. One of my favorite songs was Suffragette City by David Bowie. So I was doing a terrible, terrible rendition of Suffragette City, trying to practice it. And all of a sudden, someone knocks on the door. And I open the door, and it's David Bowie. And he's staying at the same hotel right above me in the flat. And he says, John, great to meet you. Would you like to have a drink? Come on upstairs for a drink. And I say, oh, God, that'd be great. Don't bring the guitar. they would call me Larry the lecturer at the dinner table because I always felt like it was important to sort of, I don't know, try to teach them something, but I taught them a little bit too strongly every dinner. And sometimes if you have one beer right before you sit down at the dinner table, you might have that slight little buzz that makes you more intense.